Hey everybody, Zeke with Talking Lead, and
left hand here.
Okay.
And we are at Maximus Arms in Franklin, Tennessee.
That's right. Maximus Arms is a relatively new 1911 company. They do custom 1911s from scratch. And we're here with Tony and Mark. And Tony is actually the founder and creator of the Maximus 1911.
Actually, I didn't create it, but I did make it better.
Okay. All right. Gotcha. And Mark, you work here too?
Yes, I'm the shop manager.
Okay. Gotcha. And then you're going to actually take us through, and we're going to make a 1911 here.
And we're going to make a 1911 as well.
We're going to do one?
You're going to make one.
Something unique here, guys, is we're going to start and show you from scratch. I mean, not just the parts, but actually going through and making the part.
From a block of steel to this. Is it in?
Yeah,
it's in.
You're way in.
Yeah. Okay, all right, just making sure.
Do it one more time.
With my hand. Actually, a block would be a billet.
Okay.
And this is molten steel. We actually pour this. They create the steel.
Wow.
By putting various additives and the composition is many different things together to create the 17-4 precipitated hardness steel.
Wow.
And then they pour that while it's molten hot into the molds.
Wow.
So there you have it. That's what we're going
to
do.
And then we're going to get to see it from that point, getting CNC'd, then all the way down to putting the trigger in, the springs, everything that goes into the 1911. You're going to get to see it here. So I guess now y'all set up an appointment for us at the,
you call it
the smelting place?
Yeah. Smelting, yes.
The smelting place. So we're going to go there.
It's a foundry.
Then we're going to the foundry. We're going to go to the CNC place, and hopefully left hand won't be wearing that the whole time, because that foundry is going to be pretty hot.
I think it looks kind of good on.
I thought it looks good on.
We'll see. Yeah, all right. Yeah. So we just left Maximus Arms over in Franklin, Tennessee, and Mark has brought us here to
Precision Castings of Tennessee.
All right.
And
I think I got it.
Ted Bransford here with us. And he's gonna give us a tour, show us how the 1911 is smelted, as we've said a bunch of times.
The smelting.
The smelting. And
I think the secret of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is here also.
It is.
Really?
The
secret of the ooze?
Secret of the ooze.
That's it. Ooh.
Guys, I'm here with Ted, and we're in the wax room now, and he's going to talk about the pattern for the Maximus Gladiator.
Yeah, each of these machines is a wax injection machine. We're injecting molten wax into an aluminum mold to form the part. And this is what we'll use throughout our process. Our process is utilizing the lost wax method. It's been around about 6,000 years. It didn't become a production tool until right after World War II, when they needed net-shaped parts to drive costs down from fabrications or stampings or other means of manufacturing. So on the 1911, this is what you would get coming out of the frame. And as you can see, it's a blank. Mm-hmm. We have these odd looking shapes on here, which is a means of feeding the metal into it. These are what we call gates.
Okay.
Which will be removed after they're cast.
So the metal will go into?
Will flow into these metal channels, these gates, and fill the part. As you can see, we cast a great deal of detail on the inside. Your trigger bow side, the trigger opening, the hammer, the mag release are all cast to size. Everything for your mag area is cast to size.
Yep.
We have machine stock on the outside, so we can do multiple variations of the weapon by doing different machine operations. So we take, after we inject them, we take this wax pattern, now we'll set it up onto what we call a tree or an assembly, and then now go into our dip room.
Okay, so step two in the wax room, we're going to the wax tree?
Tree.
Or
sprue.
Sprue. And from here, what you're doing is you're attaching the
wax pattern.
The patterns onto the tree.
Onto the tree and making one assembly. You can see here that the different part, different configuration, but same principle. We use a hot plate to melt the gate. A little stick tight glue. She attaches it to the tree. And then she'll use a jeweler's torch, which is generated by hydrogen, and wax welded together. So it's one flawless seam assembly. And now she's wax welding the parts to the tree or sprue. And when she's done with that, This part would be then dipped, and from my hand down would be encapsulated into a ceramic shell.
Okay.
And once we get that shell thick enough to withstand that thermal shock, we'll melt the wax out. And then you'd have a void. That's the term lost wax.
Okay. Very cool.
Got the wax tree made, and it's got the 1911 frame hooked up to the tree or the
sprue.
And if you stuck this into the kiln right now, it'll all just melt, right?
That's correct.
So you have to wrap it with a ceramic layers, a few ceramic layers, which we start right here, right?
That's correct. And this will be our first dip. This is a zircon based slurry, and it's a very high temperature, very strong. And what they'll do is they'll take this wax part. Slurry. They'll rotate that around and get a nice even coat. This is the most critical dip because what you see here is what you get. Surface finish comes from the mesh that we use in our flour. So we use about a 325 mesh, which gives it about 125 surface finish. So they'll take this and they go into a raindrop sander. We use a zircon sand to cover the first dip.
Now you keep saying zircon based. Is that the same stuff that they make cubic zirconias out of?
That's exactly what they make it from.
So this vat right here, I think it's your big old cheap fake diamond engagement ring.
If you
make,
do it right.
And make you look good.
Yeah.
You guys don't happen to make those here, do you?
No, not yet. But we're looking
not yet.
It.
This is after the
first
1911, but it's what it would look like.
So you have parts that actually go into shears for cosmetic equipment, rail cars, and then you have barrel liners for the 50 cal, the M2. These are cobalt-based barrel liners that allow the gun to operate fully automatic without melting the barrel.
Okay.
And we do thousands of them.
And then after you do this first step, we go on to another slurry,
another
right?
Dip. And what we're going to do is we're just going to go through a series of progressively thicker dips.
Okay.
To get the shell the thickness that we need.
Okay.
Slurry.
And this is actually a ceramic slurry versus a zirconium slurry.
Okay. All right.
So it'll be dipped. It says dry. We'll get a nice even coating on it.
Almost looks like banana pudding.
Wants to eat the lime banana pudding.
Tail's getting to be lunchtime.
Then we'll go into what we call our G2, our little heavier grain, and that raindrop sander will adhere the sand to it. And what this is, this allows the fine grains of the zircon dip to adhere to our backup dip. So it's just an intermediate grain.
So basically, y'all found a way to monetize all the fun stuff you did on the playground as a kid.
That's exactly
you
right.
Play with mud and dirt and sand and...
Yeah, and get paid for it.
And you figured out a way to make guns out of it.
That's right.
Which is awesome. Now, we were talking about the secret of the ooze. That really looks a lot like...
That's not it.
And I'm going to tell the EPA about it.
Okay. All right. We'll hide that one.
This is our backup slurries. We might put 3 or 4 dips of this thing on the part to give us the thickness to withstand that thermal shock. So here again, it'll go into the slurry. We'll get a nice, heavy, even coat. Go into a fluidized bed, which will put a heavier grain. And this is a ceramic material. On there, matter of fact, this material is mined in Andersonville, Georgia. There's only 2 deposits in North America, one's in Canada, one's in Andersonville, Georgia. And during the glacier period, as glaciers melted, it pushed that deposit down there.
Okay.
So here you can see the M2s, barrel liners.
The 50 cals.
50 cals. These go in paper mills, and these go in rail cars.
And then eventually we get to this point over here. This is as much dipping as... Okay. I know all the trolls on our channel are gonna see this shape. What is this?
this part actually goes on the Bradley, as an armor personnel carrier.
Yeah, so it's a Bradley part. Tank piece.
That's it.
It's not what it looks like.
And that's made from the same metal that the Maximus Gladiator is made from, right?
A lot of them are, and being a custom job shop, we can pour anything. Anything can be poured in air, so we can pour low alloy, high alloy, nickel base, cobalt base, bronze, brass, and aluminum. What we've done here is encapsulated those barrel liners for the M2 into a ceramic shell. We still have the wax opening here, and we're going to melt all that wax down through that opening.
So all the stuff that left hand showed you with the wax tree is underneath the ceramic.
That's correct. And when we melt that wax out, then there's a hollow void that's left of the exact configuration of the wax pattern.
Okay. How exactly do you melt the wax out of there?
We use an autoclave system, which is a pressure vessel. Wax expands and contracts with temperature, so the shell doesn't. So as it melts, if you don't have pressure around it, your shell will actually crack. Your wax will expand and crack your shell. So we dump about 110 pounds of pressure, steam, into that vessel that holds the shell together while the temperature melts the wax out.
Awesome.
Then we take that wax, we recycle it, and it gets sent back in the same form, so we start the process all over again.
All right, so now we get to go see some molten lava, right?
That's it.
Go see some hot metal. That'll work. Hey, left hand.
Yeah.
A little hot in there. Pour the steel, and Ted's going to tell us a little bit about what's going on down there.
Yeah, what we're doing is we're getting ready to pour off a heat, about 700 pounds of 17-4 at about 2,980 degrees. And this is what we call our casting operation. And you'll see, it's pretty neat.
Yeah. Just take a look. I'm already starting to sweat.
Yeah.
Process. What are they doing right now?
Right now they're bringing the molten metal up to temperature. We have set procedures for each part that we pour. It has to be poured at a certain Fahrenheit.
Okay.
So you see that the induction furnace is cranked up. They're getting ready to take the immersion pyrometer. They're getting the reading. The reading will come up here on the digital readout.
900 degrees is what it said?
No, actually he burnt the tip off of that. And that was an erroneous reading, so he'll re-tip it.
So it's 104 just standing out there.
Yeah, very very warm up there on the pad.
That's the need for those suits.
2938 Fahrenheit.
That's quite a bit different than 900, isn't it? That was an erroneous reading. What's it got to be to pour?
I think he's probably going to pour about 2948.
Okay, so another 10.
Anytime you are.
All right, guys, so here we go. We're getting ready to see the pour.
The gentleman on the right is what we call our pole man. He'll be bringing the shells out to be poured into.
Does he hate having that name?
Well, that's pole man. That's better than the dummy end. On our pouring shank, you have one gentleman on the end that just holds the weight. The other one does the pouring. So you have the pour and thus the dummy end.
Okay.
And then the guy on the pad is our master melter.
They keep it simple, right?
Keep it simple.
So if you had us do this, you'd end up with two dummy ends.
It would be jack wagons.
We affectionately refer to that as the three stooge syndrome. So what they brought out here now is the transfer ladle. That transfer ladle is at 1900 degrees Fahrenheit. So now they're going to bring out the shell.
Ooh.
Those sparks.
Man, look how bright that is.
They'll set one shell, they transfer the metal over, and then the pour into the mold.
They're doing this at a pretty good pace.
Yes. These guys work really well together. They pour everything from chicken processing equipment to Hellfire missile parts.
That's not a prospect.
Wait a minute, so you're saying our Hellfire missiles are made of chicken processing equipment?
Actually, the exact same metal.
The exact same metal? Same metal that these frames are made of, 1911 frames from Maximus.
That's correct.
So one bucket
per assembly, yes. Per shell or mold.
Per shell or mold, okay. Man, I can't, look at that, it's like lava, man. How does that compare to the heat of lava, you know?
I would imagine that you're probably about...
hotter, isn't it?
About 800, 900 degrees hotter.
Wow.
Well, it feels like it's increased about 20 degrees from up here where we're standing.
Yeah, it's already gotten hotter.
It's very warm up here.
Yeah. How many gallons is in that?
That's a 90-pound ladle.
90 pounds?
And he doesn't pour everything into the mold, but he's pouring about 56 pounds into each mold.
Okay.
So we get 8 1911 frames per pour.
So 8 1911s per pour of that bucket.
That's correct.
We've got 4 going so far. This would be the 5th one.
And then what's the step they go to after this?
You go in what we call the shakedown.
Okay, and that's that pneumatic hammer?
Pneumatic hammer, and what it does is it vibrates and the shell falls off. The shell, as it solidifies, or as metal solidifies, the shell becomes weaker and it becomes brittle. So when they do, when they introduce the vibration to it, it just cracks and falls off.
I'm gonna get as close as possible without the camera melting. Ooh, it's hot. So these are 1911 frames from Maximus Arms.
That is hot right there, guys.
All right, so now what they're gonna do is they're gonna take, the 1911s are still a little hot, so they can't take it in a pneumatic hammer yet, but we've got some ambidextrous thumb safeties that basically they're gonna take the ceramic part and it's gonna be a pneumatic hammer that hammers it off, and then you're gonna end up with these here. Kind of see it right in there.
Ooh. Was that supposed to do that?
I didn't just ruin a whole thing of thumb safeties.
You probably get you by.
Except the pneumatic hammer is going to do it a heck of a lot better than I'm doing it right now. I'm being dainty because I'm scared to break something.
Yeah,
don't want to
bend it.
Alright, so he's going to be hooking it up to the jackhammer now, the pneumatic hammer. And those are the safety. Just like that. There they are. All right, so after this process, where do we go to next?
We go over to the cutoff area and we'll remove these parts with abrasive cutoff wheel. Remove them from the runners, remelt the runners, and process the parts.
All right, let's go check that out.
Okay, what we have is we have an automatic cutoff saw and a manual cutoff saw. And what we're going to do is the Hellhunter is going to bring over the part you just saw shook out, and we're going to remove the parts using a manual cutoff saw.
Okay, so it's just going to slice the little pieces off where they're supposed to be sliced off.
That's correct.
So this is where he cuts the parts off.
He's cutting parts off?
So this is where he's cutting parts off. Too bad Lorena Bobbitt didn't have a machine like this.
What? Old. The brave man.
Are you able to recycle that metal from the
That's exactly what we do. We take the heads and gates, we'll remelt them, we'll analyze them, certify them to the specification that the customer wants, and we try to recycle everything that we can.
Saying that the reason there's not a lot of sparks in that metal was why again?
Well, 17-4, a precipitating hardening stainless steel, has very little carbon.
Okay.
Usually the carbon generates the sparks that you see when the metal's being cut or poured or ground. And it has a lot of chrome, has a lot of nickel, has a lot of copper in it, but very little carbon.
Okay. Makes sense.
So how's that work for deli slicing meat there?
Actually, we do work for the deli slicing meat industry, and it's a different type of
that one looks like it stainless. Would cook the meat as it was slicing.
That's it. Slice and dice.
Slice and dice at one time.
Okay, I can't figure this out. I'm just going to... Does it count as muzzling us if I kind of do that? I don't know. But it's cool because I can make the little parts move and stuff, too. But this is how they perfected the Maximus Arms 1911. On this little program.
All right, guys, so that's it here at Precision Castings of Tennessee. We're here with Ted. We'd like to thank Ted for showing us around and sharing the process with us. Here's the finished frame of the Gladiator. And next, we go to the CNC process.
We can't go to the CNC. It's super secret squirrel.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well,
so we'll just go back
to that part. Remains a secret. But you get the idea of everything from here. Ted, thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Appreciate it,
Ted.
Nice thank you.
Mm-hmm. Foundry. So we're back from the foundry, and I'm a little sweaty because it's hot in there.
Yeah.
And
we say about 9 million degrees
at least. Somewhere around there, yeah. I mean, it's really hot.
We're starting to see that one integral part of building a Maximus 1911 is heat.
Yes, it's definitely required. It's actually in our SOP.
Great. And y'all are making me build one by myself while he gets your help.
I get the tutorial. Zeke's going to get all the parts. He's going to go over to the side and he's going to build one on his own.
We'll see how that goes. So we're in the shop now. What are we going
to
do?
Yes. Right now we're going to go over to Ryan and he can be lapping a frame and slide together.
Okay.
Lapping. Not lap dancing.
Interesting.
Lapping.
Okay. Let's take a look at this.
All right. This is Ryan. And what he's doing, he's going to be lapping the slide to the frame. That way they have that nice smooth sliding back and forth.
That's a motion he seems to be very proficient at.
Yes. Very comfortable with this.
Yes. I'm pretty good at that.
A lot of practice, huh?
Plenty of practice.
Well, since you've had a lot of practice there, Zeke, we're going to have you lap one yourself.
I'll have to lap one myself.
Oh, yeah. You want to get a feel for what you're building.
Okay, gotcha.
So, yeah, it starts off really tight, and then as you can see, it starts to get really buttery.
And that's the technical term, right?
That is the technical term for lapping to buttery.
Buttery, B-U-D-D-E-R-Y?
Oh, definitely. We're in the South. Buttery. Okay.
Buttery. So are you ready to put your own gun together?
I'm looking at it. Seriously, I don't get any instructions.
No, just, here's a bag. Parts.
It's pretty self-explanatory, right?
You saw my 1911 review, right?
Oh, he just went and took one apart and put it together for us.
All right.
You can do this.
All right, leave me alone. I'm going to figure this out.
All right, so where do we go next, Mark?
All right, so we are going to go to Keegan. And we're going to have Keegan show us how he's putting a gun together after we're lapping it.
Okay, so after the lap. All right, go through each part with us here, Keegan.
All right, we're going to do trigger, mag release, sear, disconnector, pins, hammer, main spring housing, sear spring, grip safety, thumb safety, detent, and then we'll throw our slide on top.
And a whole bunch of little screws in there. A
whole bunch of little grip screws.
All right, commence.
No. We have a gun. It's ready to test fire.
All right. So that's the next step?
So yes, sir. That would be the next step.
All right. Sounds good. Let's check in on Zeke, see how he's doing over here.
All right.
All right, Zeke, so how's it going over here?
It's freaking hot. I'm sweating even more. I'm getting there, though. Can I use this?
Sure. If you think pounding the metal together works.
I know if I do that motion, which I'm good at, no?
No.
No.
Mm-mm. No. Should we come back and check on him?
Yeah, give him a few more minutes. He'll figure it out.
I'll get it.
All right, so Mark here is going to do the test firing. And he's going to explain to us how they go about doing this indoors.
Yeah, okay, so what we have here is a snell. And it basically, when you shoot the round into it, it tumbles it like that and ends up in a big pile of mess down at the bottom. And what we do right here is we stand about this close to the snell. The barrel doesn't go inside it, just right out to the face of it. And then at kind of like a slight downward angle. And we just fire the gun from there. So first thing is safety. So we got our ear protection on. And eye protection.
Get your ears on.
And the next step we yell out is ears, so that everybody knows to plug their ears or put ear pro on. Ears! Clear!
So how would you say that test run went?
That went really well. No hiccup at all. If there was a hiccup, we would actually take the gun apart, inspect it, make sure there is no burrs or anything inside the trigger well, inside the frame, slide, barrel. We'd remove all that stuff and start the process over again.
So what's next after the test fire?
After we test fire it, we melt the gun together, make it look all nice and pretty, get all the lines formed together, and remove any rough metal on there, make it a smooth surface.
Get rid of the burrs.
Burrs and all that stuff. And then we bead blast it. And after we bead blast it, we put the sights on it, get it approved, and put it away. And start again. Whole process.
Ears! All right, here we go. Am I good?
Go for it, more.
They win.
When?
Right here?
Yes.
Flitter! All right, guys, so that's how you build a 1911 from start to finish. True start to finish. Man, I can't thank you guys enough for letting us come and
I know,
do
thank
this.
You very much.
I know Zeke is still in the process of building his. I think he's just about done. Looks like he's got some help over there, some rather attractive help.
Yeah, let's go check on him.
Is that Miranda he's got over there?
It is.
Let's go check on him and see what he's doing over there. You about done?
Okay, so.
Holy cow, son.
It's been a little rough. And I had the beautiful face of Maximus Arms come in here, Miranda, and I tried to impress her with a pink paperclip, and I don't think it worked.
A pink paperclip? What are you talking
about? Yeah.
Look what he did.
Oh, gosh.
Stunning! Duct tape? Pink paper? I couldn't figure it out! Oh, well.
Wow.
Does it need to be test fired?
Yeah, it's test fired.
So it's ready to be test fired.
I dropped the trigger, though. And then there's a bunch of parts left too. I'm not really sure if that's going to hurt the gun
so
or not.
So this is probably a lot lighter than the standard.
Yes. Yeah. That's what I was going for. I was going for a streamlined, a lot lighter.
It has the factory Loudener on it.
Yes. That's right. See, there's a method to my madness.
Yeah.
All right. So that is building the Maximus Arms Gladiator 1911.
How awesome was that?
That was fun. Man. I sucked at building my own, but.
I didn't realize
you did a good one.
I was going to ask you if you're applying for a patent.
Yeah, I am. I'm going to see if it works.
But just going to the foundry and, you know, it's just amazing how from start to finish these things are made.
Yeah. So if people want to buy one, if they want to follow you on social media, how do they do all that?
Well, they can follow us on Facebook. Okay. Just go to Maximus Arms. You can go to MaximusArms.com and find us there or any multimedia.
So you guys on Twitter, Instagram, you doing all that stuff now?
Oh yeah, Facebook, and all the other things I don't know anything about.
And then your website is?
www.maximusarms.com.
And if they want to buy one, where they go to?
You go to your local dealer. If they're not carrying them, ask them to carry them, or you can come directly through us. Just have a local dealer fax us.
And we have a retail store as well.
Okay. Sounds good. And we've got a T&E video coming soon. We're going to be testing these guns and doing some full-blown shooting out at range.
Maybe a couple of guns.
Yeah.
So as you know, yes, all are displayed. Did you guys get it for our guns? Oh, no. Guys, where's your guns?
Are we missing some guns?
Yes. Come on, guys.
All right. Fine.
All right.
Is this it?
Well, all right. All right. Okay, man. Another one.
Are you ready?
Okay.
I thought I did too.
Thank you, guys.
Hey, wait. Zeke, you have one? Man, I can't believe you, Zeke.
Oh, wow.
You got one too?
Oh, look at this. What?
All right. Do you need to pass it down?